anxiety is not a bad thing. It's a signal. It's a sign that your body, your mind feels it's in a stressful situation.
What would the world look like if people felt like they mattered? Welcome to the Lead with Love podcast, exploring what it means to lead with love in business and life. I'm your host, Jada Selner, and in this show, I'll share meaningful conversations to help you, the creative, the entrepreneur, the world changer, reach more people, go after your dreams, and serve your community with love. I appreciate you joining me. Now, let's get cozy and start today's episode. Hello, hello. Today is another solo, but not so solo episode because I have my amazing right hand, Michelle, here today. Say hello.
Hello, hello.
So excited to have you here, Michelle. So, you know, something that we do on our team meetings is we share about like what's going on, just like, how was your weekend? And then we kind of like unfurl our lives. And I always say that business is personal. And that's just the type of leader that I like to be inside my businesses. My clients are just really adding that personal connection that we can bring our whole selves to work. I always look forward to it. I feel like we dedicate like a good 15 minutes before we get into our team meetings. And some people will be like, meetings, they're a waste of time and we're not getting anything done. But I think that there is a lot of quote unquote productivity in connection and just being able to connect on a human level.
Totally. On a, not just a work level, but on a personal level. And Jada and I are both raising daughters. So I have a 12-year-old and Jada, Zoe's what, 14?
Yeah, she's 14 and in high school.
So like, how many times have I come to you asking for some type of help or support? Because it's just challenging, you know, like raising a daughter and like a teen and all of the things that they go through and all the pressures that they have. And, you know, it's really heavy.
Yeah.
And it's a lot, you know, the support that they need and like finding themselves and where do they fit in and belonging and all this anxiety. And Jada, you've always been such like a resource for me, I guess, because you do so much work, like intentional work in every area of your life. If it's like business or it's personal, you really dive deep and you like pull nuggets of wisdom to really give, you know, you and other people like practical tools to really deal with what we're all dealing with. And like raising a middle school girl is challenging and it's a lot. And we were talking a couple of weeks ago about like Elena has like some anxiety. And I know you've actually dealt with this a little bit with clients and, you know, coaching other people. So what would you say is anxiety, like from your perspective?
Yeah. So I'll first say I am not a medical professional. I am not an expert. Yes. Please consult, you know, your therapist or anything like that. I always feel like I'm a repository of information. So I love to research things. I love to study. I'm a lifelong student and I just, you know, I want to figure out how I can be my best self and how I can bring out the best in other people so that everyone can feel joyful and purposeful and just deeply connected to their lives and their purpose in the world. So I just want to preface that. I was just looking online to kind of define anxiety, and the Mayo Clinic says intense, excessive, and persistent worry and fear about everyday situations. And so that can cause like a fast heart rate, rapid breathing, sweating, and even feeling tired. And also that anxiety is not a bad thing. It's a signal. It's a sign that your body, your mind feels it's in a stressful situation. And that can be as like test anxiety, public speaking, like it can be something like that. But it also, I think in this world right now, there's an increase around social anxiety because also we're so plugged in, right? To like YouTube and phone.
And so our kids also are just like a little bit socially awkward. And
Elena certainly is. She's
And like, and the professional homebodies and like cozy. And also like our kids also feel super safe at home because they have very conscious, caring parents too. And what I started to learn, you know, Zoe was making a transition from one, the decision to transition from homeschool. So we homeschooled for middle school because there was a lot of anxiety kind of leading up to that decision. And it just like, I could see it impacting her mental health and her body and her confidence. And I think it was a beautiful thing to kind of take a step back and kind of reclaim that time with our daughter. But I can also see as we're transitioning, now we're in high school where it didn't give her enough exposure to basically deal with uncertainty, because that's what we have to do as humans, is actually we need to be put in situations to kind of train ourselves up to deal with the unknown and having those tools and strategies. So that's what I'm learning of, like, oh, I can see where my husband and I have been helicoptering and kind of like not wanting her to feel any pain or any discomfort, you know.
Guilty. Guilty of that.
And it's just because we know too much and we're like, I don't want that to happen. But then, and there's even certain things that, you know, I've done as a parent, like wanting to prevent certain things from happening, like stranger danger, you know, being physically touched by an adult. And like, I don't know, I just like, I poured a lot of like, then I created a new layer of anxiety because of being so on top of like, and this might happen and that might happen. And so these are the things that you need to know. And so just paying attention to our own personal fears and how we project and put those on to our children. That's just like something of like, oh, usually when we see whatever we're kind of putting it, pouring into our kids, is like some of that is our own stuff that we need to work out as well and kind of heal that within ourselves. So yeah, it was just very interesting where I feel like we, you know, George like painted like the world is a scary place. And then we're like, but go talk to like, go ask those people for a cup or what, like, and she like won't. And we're like, it's because like we said, the world is a scary place, like, you know, watch out. And so it's so fascinating. And then just to kind of take ownership of where we may have created that with our own children, but then also, so I started reading this book, Helping Your Anxious Teen. Who's the author? Sheila Aker Joseph's PhD. And I started listening to it on Audible. And like every 2 seconds, I'm like taking notes. I'm like, I can't just, for me with nonfiction books in general, I just can't do easy listening and just let it happen in the background. I'm such an avid student. That might be my own like anxiety of like, let's not miss a single note. So I took so many notes from her book that just gave me some ideas and tools. And then as I was looking at it, I was like, oh, wait, these are the things that like my clients and like people in running businesses that we face very similar things of an, you know, intense, excessive and persistent worry and fear, even inside our businesses. And a lot of that can come up around team, around money. You know, as an entrepreneur, you have so much more responsibility, not just for your own livelihood, but for your team's livelihood. And then you're managing and navigating emotions and moods and morale and all of those things. So there's just a lot on our shoulders, a lot of weight on our shoulders as entrepreneurs. So as I started to learn how to navigate this with my own daughter, how to navigate it within myself, and then like, oh, this is what we deal with as entrepreneurs on a daily basis too.
Mm-hmm. So what are some of the behaviors that you would see, I guess, when anxiety is heightened or.
So in the book, she kind of talked about these key things and I was like, wait, this is life. This is business. So fear of something bad happening in the future.
Okay.
Fearful thinking and worrying. The super big one that was like an aha for me was avoidance behavior.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely want to talk more about that one. Social fears and perfectionism. I was like, uh-oh. And irritability and stress. And so those are kind of like the pieces and things that kind of stress us out are like measure of worth, of worthiness. Mm-hmm. Like, am I good enough? And like, you know, for our kids, it's like they're measuring themselves using grades. And so I'm so frustrated right now because I loved homeschool so much. And now my kid is just like obsessed with grades and getting good grades and getting the straight A's and all of that. And I'm like, but I'm such a low-key parent. Like, and I'm just constantly like, I love you no matter what, no matter right. what grade you get. And then she's like, oh, all my friends' kids, you know, friends' parents are like, you know, hard on them about grades. And I was like, should I be like, now I feel like I'm too like hippie, too right. like open. And she was like, no, I'm enough. And I was like, you are enough. And I was feeling so proud of myself for a moment. But what she was saying is I'm enough of being like hard on myself that I need you. I was feeling so excited. Like, yes, she gets it. She is enough. And now she's like, so she's like, I'm good. I'm good at policing myself. I don't like, so I felt good about that, that I think she knows, and I say it consistently and I'm very persistent about you are lovable no matter what grade you get. You're like all the things. I just want her to know that, that she can be messy, imperfect, that she will still be loved and protected and safe and held. So yeah, then there's also time pressure, right? That stress, that anxiety stress comes from like, you won't get everything done. Like there's not enough time. Mm-hmm. And this is like seeing, you know, my kid trying to do all their homework. It's the same thing with business, right? Of like right. trying to get like, I don't have enough time. I got to do other things. And just kind of always in this like frenetic pace of doing. So not giving yourself permission to slow down. And yeah, so I think those are pretty big things. There's also even like around our own bodies, you know, there's so many things as kids are dealing with that I'm like, but I try to let my daughter know also, I'm like, I deal with those things too. Or like, I didn't right. figure out friends until I was like 28, like, right. you know, so to be deep and vulnerable, like I had friends in school and all of those things, but it's interesting how heightened it is for them at this younger age. But if we start to connect and think about in our own personal experiences, when was, because there's parts of me where I'm like, we didn't have to deal with it. Like, this is crazy, you know, like, mm-hmm. but yeah. So I think it's just kind of paying attention to what they're craving. And so some of the things that I've been doing research for Zoe is just finding like safe spaces. And you might find them for, you know, looking kind of locally, like, are there places that they can connect and be around their peers and have mentors outside of their parents? Because we just have too much buy-in. Like there's too much weight. So I think there's something really powerful in finding adults and mentors that can support our kids. And it's the same thing in business, right? Like our spouses, our partners, like they don't want to hear, like I was telling George about my writing day yesterday. I was like, I know you don't care about or even understand what I'm saying, but I'm just verbally processing out loud where I am in this chapter before I come home. And, you know, so I'm just like saying it, but so we need people who will listen and listen without judgment. One of the key things that they share in the book is to connect before you correct. Mm-hmm. So that was a big one of, and that's
that just, powerful.
Yeah. And it's the same for adults of like listening, right? Like listen and reflect back what you just heard and to meet someone with empathy and compassion before trying to come up with solutions and things like that.
Now, are there any specific questions that we should be like asking ourselves or, you know, that you asked Zoe maybe that kind of helped you navigate?
Yeah. This? So some of the questions in the book were, you know, thinking about your thoughts and then your feelings and your behaviors. So the question is like, what thoughts tend to trigger anxious feelings? So okay. thinking about what thoughts tend to trigger those anxious feelings. And if you're a parent kind of observing your child, you're going to start to build the menu of like, okay, when do they go down this, you know, mental right. spiral of anxious feelings? Because you'll hear them say those thoughts out loud. Like for an example could be like, you know, I'm going to get an F, you know, like I'm going to fail this test or something like that. Right. It's like, that's the thought that then, you know, oh, I have this test. And then what behaviors do you engage in to cope with those feelings? Mm-hmm. So once that thought that starts to happen, what are the actual behaviors, you know, where it could be like obsessively setting alarms so you don't forget something or studying extra hard or vegging out on food, you know, like there's just like something that might kind of to cope, because part of it is basically learning how do we cope. It's teaching ourselves, yeah. our children, like how to cope during stressful and uncertain times. That's the same thing in entrepreneurship. It's the same thing in just doing life of can we build our menu, our reserve to tend to mm-hmm. ourselves. And that's something that I do for myself, but I've also started to help Zoe build out, you know, we talked about this in a previous episode, like her play menu, like what nourishes you. And so for mm-hmm. her, she's identified like bubble baths, mm-hmm. reading books, baking, you know, hot tub time with me. So we start to build her menu out of like, okay, when you're feeling stressed, these anxious feelings come up, here's some alternative behaviors that are more nourishing.
I love that.
Yeah. Oh, so
good.
I'm just asking those questions. I've also, you know, finding ways, especially connecting with their teens, is finding like neutral spaces to have conversations with them. So one thing I learned, you know, even having conversations with them in bed, because you're side by side and you don't necessarily have to make eye contact, but also walking around the neighborhood. Because again, we're kind of facing forward or we can look down. We don't have, there's not this like intense, you know, eye gazing situation yeah. happening. Like, and even why I do audio calls for my coaching client calls, like, so people can just like get in and be real. You know, I'll do video calls with some of my clients because they want it, but I ideally prefer audio because I'm a verbal processor, also an auditorial learner. So I can hear more than I can see things. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, just kind of tuning in, finding environment. So, you know, we'll walk our dog Beasley together and have these conversations. And then we're also moving our bodies at the same time. And then the hot tub is always a good space. Or we've even gotten like ice cream and just sit in the car. Oh, another thing that's on Zoe's menu is just driving around in the car and listening to music. Mm. And so it's teaching our kids and ourselves to have self-awareness of like what our needs are and what makes us feel good. And it was so sweet because I remember one day we were driving home and she's like, can we just keep driving and just listen to a few more songs? You know, because she identified that awareness of like, that makes me feel good. And so mm-hmm. she likes long road trips. And, you know, as a family, we all rotate. We're like playing DJ and like every person gets a turn to listen to whatever song they want to listen to in the car. So yeah, what behaviors do they engage in to cope with those feelings? And do those behaviors trigger new thoughts and new behaviors? So kind of paying attention to like, okay, so now I do this thing. And is this next thought and behavior taking me down a deeper negative spiral, or is it actually helping me spiral out of it? So those are the questions of like, what thoughts tend to trigger the anxious feelings? What behaviors do they engage in to cope with those feelings? And do those behaviors trigger new thoughts and new behaviors?
Yeah. The menu again, I'm going to definitely have to sit with Elena and have her write that. Those are really some powerful tools.
Yeah. And you as a parent can be a note taker observer too. So sometimes I'm just like writing notes down so that I can be like, okay, great. Like help ground me in what I'm observing in them without needing to like get her in the weeds of everything.
Well, I was just going to say like, so what doesn't work and what tools can you use to help cope with anxiety?
Yeah. Yeah. So some of the things that they say don't work is telling someone to stop thinking about the fears.
Yes. Don't do that.
Yeah. Because when they're real to that person in the moment.
Right. We have to honor that.
Yeah. And fear. Mm-hmm. So we can't like dismiss them. So that's like something of like, I'm feeling dismissed or like not believed about the feeling. And like what we think is small, like that's nothing, is really big to that person who is having an anxious thought, feeling fear, worry about that. So really trying to learn how to understand from their perspective and like, thank you for sharing that with me. Tell me more, you know? Mm-hmm. And then another thing is allowing the avoidance of fears. And so this is where as adults, we begin to adapt and modify behavior to help them not feel anxious. And you actually don't want to do that. guilty.
I'm guilty too.
You know, you just, and we actually did this, our dog Clementine, who we had for 13 and a half years and had to put her down a few years ago. She was a very anxious, reactive dog, always barking at other dogs, just so stressful for us to walk her. And so walk her as much. Like, you know, we started building like this cocoon around her. And so we would avoid engaging with people, like just walk down another street, avoid. So we never gave her like the tools, and we didn't give ourselves the tools either to like help her calm those anxious feelings. But the avoidance doesn't help them learn how to cope or to desensitize. And I think especially as parents, our kids are going to go out in the world and be adults without us. Mm-hmm. And so we want them to feel the anxious feel because they have caring and loving people at home to support them and guide them through that and learn how to cope. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So I would do all kinds of things. So like, I don't want to deal with this, like this episode of like, you know, and so we modify space or like, okay, we won't go there or, you know, so just finding avoidance is like, is a huge one and you just need to stay with them in that. And again, the connect before you correct. And then the other part is jumping in with advice, especially when they're in it, right? So you think about when we had toddlers and it was like, you can't reason with a tantrum. You just can't. They're not like trying to impart wisdom, right? Like not when you're in the height of fight or flight, right? Your body is activated and is stressed and is scared. And so to try to impart wisdom and dismiss and like that, it's just, it's creating, it's nurturing that cycle, but they're also not able to receive it if you're jumping in with advice at the height of our anxiety, right? So the same thing with ourselves, like when we're at the height of the anxiety, sometimes we're looking for the solution, like, got to do this, got to do that. Like just throw money at the problem, do this. Like, and it's like, we just got to let ourselves like one, just name it. What we're feeling, that we're scared, and empathize with ourselves of like, oh, honey, you're scared. And allow ourselves, our kids, to feel the feelings instead of demanding a quick change right in that moment. So that's the time as a parent to take a mental note. Okay. Oh, what are the thoughts? What are the feelings? What are the behaviors? I'm just going to make a note. And then when we're in a not heightened state of anxiety, then we can have a deeper conversation to explore that. But in the heat of it, it's very intense. And I think as humans, especially, you know, and as parents, we want to minimize the fear as quickly as possible, right? We're always rushing, like, got to fix it, got to solve it. Don't want to be here. This is so uncomfortable for us. It's also uncomfortable for them. But the, you know, the jumping in with advice in that time is not the best pathway to go.
So true. Yeah. I'm guilty of so many of those things, but it's out of love, you know, and not knowing out of ignorance, but you know, that's why you have to become aware.
Yeah. And you can communicate that. Like I communicate like in letting them know like why I've done these things in the past or why I'm doing it. And I caught myself and I want to make a shift. You know, you can say those things. I love this thing that they said. It said advice in the book, advice giving tells teen what to think and do, but doesn't teach them how to think and behave when anxious. So you like the advice, okay, you're like, okay, this is what you should think, this is what you should do, but it's not how to think and behave. And so that like, basically so they can start to come up with their menu, right? Like what are my ways of coping? And then there was one more is giving excessive assurance. Of like, everything is safe. Everything is okay.
Everything's going to be okay.
Yeah.
Don't worry. Yeah.
And that one's a hard one because you want them to know that they're okay. I'm still struggling with this one because I also read so many articles about like giving praise to children and like praise their effort and not their, you know, like it's such a confusing, but also sometimes kids just want you to say like, I'm proud of you or, you know, so it's an interesting dance of the reassurance piece, but that we can start to find that assurance within ourselves or that confidence that we can handle this versus always needing it from outside sources. but I'm a little confused and perplexed on that piece still, because also I know our voices carry on with them into adulthood. And it's, you know, our voices, the nagging voices, the encouraging voice, all of those are going to become their inner voices later in life when we're not around. So just being really aware and conscious of, you know, the words that we say and the thoughts that we give to them.
And so what are some of the tools that have worked for maybe your clients or Zoe to help cope with the anxiety?
I would definitely restate the connect before you correct.
Yeah.
I think that piece that really stood out to George too. He listened to the book as well. Mm. So just empathy and active listening and being able to put yourself in their shoes and to reflect back what you hear. Okay. So what I hear you're saying is, you know, you're feeling nervous about this upcoming test or this launch or, you know, like, so just letting them know, even if it feels exaggerated or whatever, that you hear them. And like the best way to acknowledge to someone that you heard them is to really just repeat back what you just heard them say. Yeah. And then I say another, you know, they say to externalize anxiety and talk back to it. So this is something that my good friend Amy Ehlers talks about in her book, The Inner Mean Girl, and or Inner Mean Girl Reform School. And so kind of making a visual picture that this anxiety or this fear, this worry, this negative self-talk is not you. It's something separate from yourself. And so we went to like a mother-daughter workshop and we did like this inner mean girl exercise where we had to draw our inner mean girl and then give her a name. And I think mine's is patronizing Polly. And she's just like in this regal, like queen dress and just like, you know, just like, you're not doing enough, or no, you're doing it wrong is my big mental loop. Like I'm not doing it right. So I tend to have a lot of like anxious feelings, which, you know, they're all coming up as I write this book of like, of I'm doing it wrong. And so I over research, I over like, because I don't want to get it wrong, but being able to kind of externalize that anxiety outside of yourself. So giving them a nickname, a visual image, and you don't have to call it anxiety. Because to me, like sometimes anxiety feels like a very like heavy word. And also, you know, it's a medical term too. And so we're not professionals to like diagnose all of those things. So you can call it fear, worries, stuck thoughts, spam thoughts. They had an example of OTT, over the top fears. So yeah, just being able to externalize it outside of yourself and being able to talk back to the anxiety inside your mind of like, okay, anxiety, or okay, fear, I see that you're there. So just, you know, separating it from who you are. And so that also when you do that, then you can be on the same side as your child. And then the opponent is the fear, the worry, the anxiety. And so the problem is not your teen's behavior. It's like, oh, what's that? That wildly acting fear girl, just all up. So one quote that they shared is like, I see that anxiety has gotten you stuck. Let's see how we can work together to stop anxiety making you miss the event. Like that was like, I've literally like transcribed so many notes from just like listening, but I love those things of like little scripts and things that we can follow. And then also starting to teach our kids and ourselves to challenge negative thinking. And they mentioned kind of common thinking errors, which is all or nothing, right? It's either good or it's bad. It's perfect or it's a failure. Another one is mental filter, like only noticing the negatives and completely discounting positive events when they occur, which is why, you know, with my clients, every coaching call, every vision and planning retreat, we always celebrate our wins. Yeah. Before we go into like solving a problem so that we can be in gratitude of like, it's not all bad, even if this one thing isn't working. Another common thinking error is mind reading. So jumping to the conclusion that someone perceived you negatively, catastrophizing, which is like fearing the worst, and overgeneralization, which is making a too broad conclusion based on a single event or single piece of evidence. So yeah, those are the big ones.
And powerful ones. So yeah, thank you for sharing them.
So these are just like a few things to one, just kind of be aware of. I would just say like the biggest takeaway is connect before you correct. And then know that that fear is not you. and to really kind of let that be outside of you. What would you say are like your big takeaways, insights from kind of discussing some of my notes?
Definitely to connect, for sure, before you correct. And I'm pretty good with doing that. Another thing that you said that was really powerful to me was just being really transparent and like letting your team know, hey, I struggled with this. You know, it took me until I was in my 20s to figure out friends and those type of things, to let them know that where you are is normal. It's hard. I see that it's hard. I see that it's challenging, but we're going to work together to try to help you cope, right? Yeah. And not necessarily take all of their problems away, because we're not going to be with them forever and they need to have those skills to do it on their own, but to give them the support and the love of, hey, we see we have a common enemy and we can work together to help you work and move through it. Yeah. And then the menu I think is so powerful. For me, like to have my own and to maybe see some things in Elena that I think that she would really enjoy. And then like having her become self-aware and say, okay, when I'm feeling this way, what would pull me out of that space?
Yeah.
You know, so we can have some little things that we can do to help pull her out of her funk or her patience moment. So,
and that one's not from the book. That was just, that's my own little
Jotto wisdom.
And also modeling how we cope with stress and fear and worry, anxiety, like how you were saying, like modeling that we can also model our menu of like, here are some things that I do. So I think that's so, so helpful. So there's so much more we could talk about when it comes to fear and worry, and but just like starting to build our resilience and our menu for coping so that we can tolerate uncertainty and the unknown a little bit better. So thank you all for listening and having this conversation, and sending you lots of love until we talk again. Thank you so much for your heart and attention and listening to Lead with Love. You can always get the links and resources mentioned in each episode over at leadwithlovepodcast.com, so that you can build a sustainable business and live a creative life on your terms. If this message, leading with love, resonates with you and you want to take a stand for remembering that there are humans with beating hearts behind the numbers, I would love for you to subscribe so you never miss an episode and leave an honest review. It would mean the world to me, and it also helps more people spread more love in the world, which we really, really need. I also love hearing from you. So as you're listening, take a screenshot, share your favorite takeaway, and tag me on Instagram and Facebook at Jotta Selner. I really appreciate you, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye.